Barber Shop Podcast, episode number 170, coming to you live from Box O Studio. You think I'm fucking with you? I ain't. Right, Cannon? I know you've been looking forward to this show for a long, long time. We've been chatting about it for a while. We just needed the perfect situation. Yeah. And the perfect situation being is I never bothered booking a show with a singer-songwriter. And when I started calling last week, everyone had something to do. So, because I know 50 drummers, I thought, man, let's do the show. Let's do the drummer show, because we live in a global village where in every corner of the world, no matter how xenophobic and insular that country is, there's artists that pop out. You know, they can be squished and repressed. They come out. And in those artists, there are drummers. And before, I mean, predating the monosynth even, you know, before there was a guitar, a stringed instrument, there was some sort of troglodyte banging on a log, making music.
I thought we weren't going to do any drummer jokes.
It's not a joke. It happened. Seriously, like rhythm is the basis of everything. No, I'm not saying because he's a, like, that troglodyte was a rockin' troglodyte. He was a troglodyte. He was happening amongst the other troglodytes, right? But he was like, listen to this log. It sounds different on this side, and I get pussy when I play this log really good, right? And there was the birth of music. And so we said, we're gonna do a drummer show. And I said, I mean, keep in mind, this is 2 days ago, because I'm fucking screwed for a show. I'm thinking, I'm gonna invite like the top flight drummers to come to this show and explain about the what is about drums and percussion, their history, their stories. We're gonna talk about drums. We're gonna give them the spotlight. And I asked the very best guys, and they were all busy. But I got these guys. I got some wicked guys anyway. These are guys that, you know what, unless you're in the business, you probably never heard of. If you're in the business, you see and hear their names a lot. They're good enough to play with anyone in the world, and it's true. Instrumentally, it's absolutely true that Hamilton has a reputation that this is a town that you can build a band in. And timekeepers and drummers, It's a wonderful thing, because from the outside you see that as a bit of a utilitarian effort that it's a timekeeping, it's a structural, it's a mathematical, it's a confining aspect of the band. It's like the warden that keeps everyone together. And yet the drummer is often the wild man and the crazy one. And there's this dichotomy within the drums where it's primal and it's structural and it's mathematical, and yet it's also so musical. And something that you could easily try to minimize into the most base element, in fact, is perhaps the most expressive element of music. So we're going to explore all aspects of drums and drummer. Yeah, and we're doing it with four great dudes, and I'm going to ask you one by one, just tell me your name and tell me how long you've been playing drums. We're going to start with you, Adam.
Adam Cannon, 14 years, I believe. 2001?
Right.
I don't know. I do math only in fours.
Yeah.
And the guy sometimes
next,
three.
The guy next to you, I guarantee you, has underwear older than that.
Right? And I am George Kaloxilos.
And how long have you been playing?
I've been playing the drums for about 33 years now.
33 years.
I'm not quite sure my name.
We'll give you one. You
know, half my buddies call me Billy, the other half call me Bill, right? So, right. Yeah, sure, whatever you want to call me. About 30 years.
Billy Spencer, 30 years in the business. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, man.
And?
I'm Nick Burson. I've been playing 32 years.
32 years. So amongst us, we have over a century, over 100 years of drumming experience. Now, I'm going to throw it around a little bit before we get into the, aspects of who inspired you and why you started playing the drums. And we've actually got, thanks to Nick, he brought his wicked little electronic kit over here. We're going to give some examples of drumming and drumming techniques. Exactly. We're going to start with you, Nick. I've known you and I've seen you. And I love using you for studio work or live work. You're a great field drummer who can seemingly play pretty quickly lock into being a singer-songwriter and you know what not to play as much as you know what to play. Tell me about your earliest experience drumming. When do you remember starting to drum?
I remember when I was about 7, going nuts, maybe 10, going nuts to Queen, crazy little thing called Love, and Hound Dog, stuff like Jailhouse Rock, some of the songs with big snare drum fills. I started to do them on my legs and stuff, and then I'd be tapping at school, and my buddy next to me said, how do you do that? You know, how do you do that? I said, it was easy, you just do that. He said, no, you couldn't do anything. And nobody else could do anything either. He said, you should play the drums. And I was 16 when I finally saw my first drum kit.
Really?
My school changed and they had a load of money. All of a sudden, 4 schools combined with a load of money and they had a drum kit. And I heard some heavy metal, I think it was Paranoid, solo coming out of this, my second day at this new school. And there was this big, big fat kid hunched over a guitar. And he was awesome, my mate Dean Clark. And I went straight into the room and just sat behind the drums. I didn't know what a hi-hat was, anything. I just started hitting toms, I think, in time. Didn't know what the rest of it did. And that was it. That's how I started. I was 16, yeah, it's pretty old. 6 months later, I was playing for money in a country band.
Because it was pretty early on.
Because I was so shit. They hired me. I couldn't play any fills, but I could keep time.
And you had no idea that was the minimalist aspect that they were chasing at the time.
From that point on, I didn't really bother practicing much. They just said, you're fucking perfect, mate. You don't know none of that shit them other drummers do. None of that. It was ridiculous. That was it. That was how I started.
You were in. Wonderful. Billy, tell me about your early days. When do you remember first starting?
Well, I remember hitting my mom's baskets, and she had this plant holder, and it had this wicked sound to it. I'd take the louvers off the doors, you know, the old doors I used to take those, and it would go tss, tss, like I could put my foot on the bottom of it, and it would make that hi-hat sound. I'm like, no way. Tss, tss. And then I'd be hitting the laundry baskets and be hitting cardboard boxes and whatever, but I think it was when my sisters used to play Black Sabbath. They used to play their albums all the time. Black Sabbath, they used to play Rush, Ozzy Osbourne. And I just got right into it. Like right away I knew I wanted to play the drums. So I asked my mom the one time, I said, listen, I want to play drums. I think I was 12 or something like that. And she said, yeah, all right, well, you're doing nothing else right now. So yeah, sure, why not? She put me into drum lessons. Took lessons for about 3 months. Once I got the basic structure, 1, 2, 3, 4, that was it. And I was on my own. Mm-hmm. And I knew, I just, poor this thing. Is it.
Start playing.
Yeah, man.
Pretty cool. George, what about you? Early days to the first kit, what happened?
I was musical right from coming out of the womb, I think. I always remember being somehow musical, but it started with vocals. And then by the time I was like 3, I was banging on every cardboard box and pot that there was and drawing little circles on them. But then as I developed, when we came to Canada, I began to actually play the air drums because, you know, my parents were both Greek Orthodox. You are not getting a drum set ever in this life. So, but what I decided to do was not just haphazardly play the wind. I would, this is my snare, and I'm going to hit the stick right in the center of the snare. And then I would focus on having specific locations for the toms and stuff. So really just using that old imagination, you know. For me, I love the old solo performers like Uncle Bert Humperdinck, Tom Jones, Neil Sedaka, a lot of those guys, and that's just the beginning of the list. But they're the ones that really initially influenced me, and their drummers were fantastic drummers.
The best studio guys.
Oh my God.
Going, right?
Unreal. And then finally got myself a radio where I heard the first channel at this radio station I ever heard, which was CJJD. And the first song I ever heard on that channel was Ace Frehley's solo album, New York Groove.
Yeah, I had it.
Which was. No, that's not. It's a cover song. It's a cover. Yeah. I didn't know it was a cover for so many years.
Ace is deadly. Yeah. He's an underrated guitar player.
Absolutely.
The old Kiss thing, but yeah, it's He's great.
Absolutely. Oh, he's absolutely fantastic. His guitar solos, like, you remember them. Yeah. You know, they're so rhythmical and perfectly simple. So I went from, you know, going to those old style guys to the Buddy Hollies. Yeah. And learning a lot of that through time. And then barely ever did I ever study one particular guy, but I think they all managed to wind their way in there, at least a lot of them, at least little pieces of them, eh? And first it was just them, and then over the years, it slowly wasn't them anymore. It was me, you know, doing those things and playing that way.
Cool. That's a great way to put it.
All right.
Well, I guess I'm the relative newcomer.
You are. You're
in
the
this
kid.
Group. And yeah, so I was really lucky. My dad played in a pretty, like, you know, popular,
pretty
not popular
well-known band.
Yeah, I mean they were gigging for, like, on the road for, like, better part of 6 or 7 years, and
they were called
Tom Wilson and the Florida Razors.
Right. Wait.
And yeah. Yeah, I mean my dad was probably, like, my biggest inspiration, and it took me a while to kind of get into music. I was about 11. When I kind of, it really started to click. But I, like, picked up a guitar first, and I kind of taught myself E minor and A minor and some open chord type things. And he showed me some stuff because he knew a bit of guitar. But he was teaching my cousin at the time, who lived around the corner from us. And he had this little undersized Westbury drum kit. And I would go over there with him when he would teach. And I would, like, sit and talk to my aunt. And I would try to practice guitar every now and then and bring it over and whatnot, but I would hear what he was teaching. I'm just, like, you know, simple stuff, everything from, like, Mellow Yellow to, like, you know, This Is Time, This Is Four on the Floor, you know what I mean? And then one day when my cousin wasn't there, I just went downstairs and, like, I just started playing, like, you know, like, sort of like a U2 beat on the floor tom, just like bum 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 bum, you know? And I just took to it. I felt like I, just from listening and sort of having my dad, you know, talking about it and it being part of my youth, I just kind of felt it, you know? And yeah, it was just, from then on, it was bands like, I mean, obviously the Beatles and Zeppelin and all the sort of classics. And then as far as newer music goes, System of a Down was a big one that I really got into. Actually, the first song I ever played live was a Chop Suey by System of a Down. So metal was a big part of it too. And yeah, and then, you know, it's sort of, but at the end of the day, it was sort of my dad, I think, that was
And having a supportive environment like that's kind of great, right? Where it's like you didn't really feel pressure to do it, but if you said, I want to do this, we're like, absolutely.
Yeah, know, exactly. And, you know, and my mom was super cool, too. She knew what it was all about and whatnot. And, I mean, there was one year when I just started out, about 13 years old, probably, where my dad, for his birthday, bought me a cymbal. So it was like that kind of thing. Yeah. Like, he really propped me up. And, you know, it super, I had, like, the best rock and roll upbringing, I think, any kid could have asked for. So I'm really thankful for that. And that was sort of my core inspiration, getting behind it.
True blessing.
Right.
True
blessing. Right.
Yeah.
That's great.
All right. I'm going to go back to Nick, and I'm going to ask everyone, imagine for a second that you're an ad man, okay? And you are coming out with a billboard that has maybe a 10-15 word limit before you run out of space. And what you're selling is what you do, okay? And I want you to describe to me what a drummer's job is, but something that I can read as I'm driving by, at 60 miles an hour, okay? Now, there's been a, you know, because I look at it like this. I look at music like a butcher looks at a side of beef. I see the cuts, and I see the beautiful meal, you know, and I see the beautiful animal on one end, you know, and I see the mathematics in between. But the drummer, again, can impart, I think, more personality. It's often been said a good drummer will make a bad band good and a good band great. You know, it's like, really is like, I've seen it time and time again where it's like, wow, you've got four people or three people just kill, and the drummer's okay. But when you see a drummer who gets it and plays, and yet to the casual observer, they're not seeing that. They're just, it's connecting or it's not connecting. There's a disconnect there.
We'll see Rush.
You know, where it comes, yeah, I mean, here's an example. So, you know, I'm going to start with you, Nick. If someone says, like, what do you do? Because I'm a drummer. Well, what, not your job occupation, what do you do?
It's like putting a fine bone china plate underneath an expensive meal. You're laying a foundation for everything else to go on top. It's essentially a supportive role.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, and it's
keeping them in time is the number
like that,
one
that,
thing.
Yeah, that's
paramount.
It's paramount. You have to, and I think that's kind of about when you talk about grace. The definition of grace is putting someone else's interests in front of your own. That doesn't mean you're a laydown. That doesn't mean you're a walkover. That doesn't mean you're stupid or weak. That means you have grace. Unless that's a wonderful thing to have. And my good friend Jerry Gregg, who's a bass player, he describing a bass player as a similar thing. The great bass players are the black velvet behind the photograph of the necklace. You know, you can put that necklace on this table and take a picture of it, or you can put it on a piece of black velvet. It's the same picture, but how much more beautiful is that necklace, right?
Best lesson I ever had was a guy told me, the guy that brought me to Canada, actually, in a band, and he told me, he said, people come and pay their money to see me sing my songs. They don't come and pay money to come and see you play drums to my songs. And I thought, you arrogant bastard. But it was the best lesson I ever had. Yeah, I learned to listen to the songs. For me, anyway. Unless you're a solo drummer, Buddy Rich, or something like that, and you can make your own money generating your own, you know, livelihood playing the drums solo, you have to play other people's tune.
Reminds me of a Jack Richardson quote, no record has ever been sold on based on the sound of the snare. Yeah. You know, it's like, snare sounds great, okay, let's move on. Not going to sell any more records.
And you can sweat, and you can sweat that shit out, because there's so many aspects to drumming when you don't resign yourself to the primal nature of it, that you need to move someone, you know? You have to do that, again, the dichotomy of keeping the time and yet imparting your personality and moving someone at the same time. Mm-hmm. What do you see when you come in? Especially, you play with guys for a while, like you play with Sim Burn, and like, you know, you feel a connection to those guys, and you play, it comes easier. But if you sit down and you're just, okay, I've never played with this band before, what comes to mind? Like, what's your job?
Just, don't mind me, I'm just the backbone of this entire band. And
yeah, no.
Don't mind me, I'm just your spine.
Yeah.
They're recognized.
No, you know, I don't know. I keep everything pretty comical and pretty fun. But yet, I'm pretty serious when I play. Like, I'm pretty particular when I'm in a band. And I like to keep everything tight and everything, like all shots, all crashes, all everything together with the guitars, bass, vocals, whatever it is. And I don't know, I just think we got to be tight as a band, and I want everybody else to, you know, be exactly the same way.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No,
maybe I'm a little anal, but
I think it's when you have a sloppy drummer, it allows everyone else an excuse to get off the train, right? And as long as the drummer is, it becomes very obvious who's not pulling their weight, right? And again, it's a subtle, beautiful thing you're gonna see tonight. Okay, George, like talk about that side. Talk about the mystical side. Not so much as like, my job is to, you know, make sure that people don't screw up.
Yeah, but, no, I wasn't gonna say that at all. What I was gonna say was, I've come up with a phrase lately. I'm sure it's not original, but it really does describe what we do. It's heart math. It's, you know, that's kind of what it is. Like the object, like Nick was saying, it sits on something. An object has to sit on something. Back at Westdale, I used to draw apples in midair, you know, and my teacher used to say, object sits on some, OSOS. And that is what we are. We are that basis of
the canvas, almost.
The canvas, the white page. And now, when you have a three-piece, it depends on the number of people in the band. When you have three pieces in a band, then you're often asked to carry a little more than just the ground level. And oftentimes, thanks to studio magic, what we're hearing is something way more intricate, way more complex, a greater number of tracks, doubling, tripling, adding
sampling
on top of sampling. So when I was a kid, growing up around 10 years old, I really didn't realize that there was such a thing as studio magic. So here I was listening to some songs going, wow, this guy's like an octopus. I need to do this.
And you know how many kids did it because they thought it could be done, right? I guarantee you.
I thought Marvin Gaye had two voice boxes because he harmonized with himself.
And they'd be really loose, too. Parts all over the place. Cool.
Multi-tracks. Yeah. What about you, Adam Cannon? You are designing a side of a cube van that has the drummer's intent and purpose inside. What do you write on it?
It's to make the girls' bums move.
Yep. And yeah. There you go.
Control the energy.
Now, okay.
I really feel like you're kind of like the shepherd of the energy on stage. And like, if you're not feeling it, the audience ain't feeling it, you know? And your bandmates aren't going to feel it. I mean, we've been throwing around jokes and metaphors all night, but, you know, it's that goalie-ism. It's like, yeah. You know,
you're as good as
and
your
you
goalie.
Said it too, like, you know, an average band can be taken up a notch with a really good drummer. And, you know, the energy from that core of, you know, the downbeat and the backbeat with the kick and snare and your sort of intention with it and dynamics too, it's all very important. But it's like, you connect with your bandmates first and then the audience. And it is like being a good goalie. It's like the rest of the team's yeah. fucked if you don't show up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's totally. And it's and for me, it's just like are. That. You watch an average hockey team play, they can win a game yeah. 1-2 if they got a stellar goalie. Yeah. I don't know.
It's true. It's you're, true. You're well, right. No, you got to buy the goalie.
Yeah.
You got to buy the goalie. And I
buy the goalie drinks.
A lot of and it really seems drums. To me that the drums is something that appeals to, you know, the primal nature of, like, the kids. Like, all young people want to play the drums. And many great guitar players I know started out on drums. And maybe many great singers I know started out on drums. And they can still play drums better than most people. It seems that... like, if you believe that the drummer only, you know, has that, it's like, I think it's probably the most obvious early indicator of musicality is rhythm. And the connection with the bass player and the rhythm section, I mean, that's a magical thing.
And that's an interesting point too, man, because I found, like, when you, like, I don't know with you guys, but when you first start playing, it's easy to grasp onto the sort of simpler grooves and stuff like that. Like, playing, like, you know, Billie Jean, you know, it's like the four on the floor thing. But... as you progress, when you get into playing in studios, you have to play to a metronome, you have to sort of learn dynamics and stuff like that. Drums is a very tough instrument to master. It's a good, it's an easy instrument to sort of get a good, okay, well, you can teach anybody how to sort of play time. But it's like, to really get to that energy, emotional level with it, it's a tough learning curve. A lot of the time, there's a lot of, you know, I remember when I was 13 or 14, Carl Jennings sat me down, he's like, if you don't play to a metronome, you're gonna get fired on every session you get. Asked to be at, you know, it's like, and from that young age, I was like, okay, practice to metronome, and it was just like, okay, well, this is the sort of learning curve. It's pretty steep once you kind of get into the first rung of playing in like rock bands and stuff, you know, and I don't know, it's just
you're right, you know, there is something else though, and that I've noted thanks to YouTube. Thank you, YouTube.
Yeah. Thanks, YouTube. That's all. Praise YouTube. What they've
thank
done,
you,
the musical university of the world.
Yeah, and I noted that. Songs that I was trying to learn, like recently I was trying to learn Blue Jean by David Bowie, and I actually put a metronome to the song, and it was nowhere near.
Oh, yeah. No, totally.
It's totally true. The most albums that we know of are not to any metronome. It's a lie. It's a farce.
It's a lie. It really is.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
So close enough for rock and roll isn't just a cliche.
It's the truth.
It really is the truth. You know, do it as, you know, parts feel differently. You may want to slow that down. Or
yeah.
I definitely think for things like getting higher on sessions and like that sort of thing these days, though, it's like, I mean, that's more of a recent sort of development, I think, you know what I mean? Like back in the day too, and the biggest sort of group or recording session I was ever on, we didn't play to a click. The producer was like, do you guys practice to one? No. Then why the fuck would you record to one? But if you're doing the one-off thing, it's a good thing to have these days, I guess. I don't know. It's just indicative of the
time. It's
all
right here. It's true.
It all
depends on the session.
Yeah, that's it.
I think
that's
too, and what sort of drama. If you're making sessions, your focal point, yes, you should probably learn all that.
100%, yeah.
I never did. I never learned anything other than from playing with bands and listening to records. That's it. That's how I learned totally. Never had lessons.
Now I'm working on the pitch pipe.
Sometimes I really regret it because I lack technique and I lack certain things that I really wish I could have, but what I do have is pretty much me and the drummers that I've listened to. That's it.
Yeah.
So I try and hold on to that. It's I don't know. I still want to go and get lessons and learn to be really
forever
clever,
learning. I think is an important.
I learn at my own pace. Maybe that's it's obstinate of me, but
It's like everything. You're up and you're down. As long as you stay in the game, you're always going to progress. You're always going to get better. And you have to admit, it's a wonderful group of people to be around. Musicians are
absolutely.
You know, you get your occasional dink, but you know, for the most part, they're good people. And if you're going to spend your days with people, spend them with good peoples. All right, I've asked these guys each to kind of give me one example of someone who influenced them, and I kind of caught them on the spot. I didn't want to give them too much time to think about it. And it could have been a drummer or a drum track that has stood the test of time, or one that inspired them, or one that they consider timeless. But it came to mind, and I wanted it like that. I wanted it kind of fresh, and maybe after, oh, I should have done this, or I should have said that one. But this is the one I got for all the right reasons. And we're going to start with Adam. And what you picked was Annika Nils, Alter Ego.
Yeah, so I discovered this girl, this woman, a few months ago, and I just love, like, sort of her style is sort of what I like, the sort of hip-hop, sort of trip-hop vibe with some halftime sort of feels. But she's got these great, like, sort of modulation moves she makes. Where
good
she,
modulation.
Yeah, she, like, she takes it, the groove, in a completely different realm, and it's like she comes back home, and it's just really inspiring, and it's like, I've tried to steal some of her tricks and stuff like that. It's more of a recent thing, but I really dig it. It's awesome.
All right.
Check it out.
You're going to dig it too, right here, right now. Barbershoppodcast.com. Thank you. All right, all right, all right. That's Annika Nils. Is it Nils or Nillis?
Nils, I'm not quite sure.
Works. Look her up. N-I-L-L-E-S on YouTube. Annika with a K. Smoking drummer. Adam Carter, or Adam Cannon, picked her as someone he is digging right here, right now. And who we're going to dig right here, right now, is Billy Spencer, his volunteer to sit up on the kit. We thought, how are we going to do this?
Come on, Billy.
How are we going to do this? And that's exactly how we're going to do it. We're going to play a little jam. We're going to show you style, each and every guy, right here, right now. Billy Spencer, BarbershopPodcast.com. Big props to Billy Spencer stepping up first and foremost. It takes balls made of steel to be the first. Set the standard that the rest should rise to. Nice job, Billy.
Drum battles.
Nice job. Gonna give a shout out. Good work, Billy. After that, that was a new song. Let's talk about Hamilton artists. Thank you. HamiltonArtist.ca, our greatest, bestest, most wonderfulest sponsor in the world. 1141 Main Street East at Balmoral Avenue in Hamilton, just east of the Delta. 289-396-1653. HamiltonArtist.ca. They print anything on anything. They are committed to helping small businesses, artists, and musicians promote and market their ideas and their businesses. They do t-shirts, buttons, mugs. They do little things. They do big things. They have the most incredible machines. They'll do vinyl wraps, wrap your car, wrap your door, wrap the tables, or your whole damn building if you want. They do engraving. They do burning. They do etching. They do jewelry, blankets, name it. You know, they print anything on anything. They'll stitch it. They'll print it. They are price competitive, and they are local. They are Hamilton business. They are independently owned and operated, just like Barbershop Podcast. You can catch us every Wednesday on Twitch, .tv/podcastbarber. You can also catch us on Twitter at Podcast Barber, or on Facebook, or on Twitter. Oh, yeah, I said that. Anyway, just Barbershop Podcast. Three words. Barber Shop Podcast. All right. Got a drummer show going tonight, and we're asking all kinds of drummer questions with drummerly people, and we've got a real rhythm happening tonight. That's right. There is no cynicism. There's no sarcasm. There is no nothing allowed here. It is only positivity rising, rising high above it all. All right, we're going to now move on to George, and I ask everyone to pick a song. You picked a great one that a lot of us were like totally, like, even as someone who never played drums, that was one of the first songs that the drum line just, it grabs you right off the bat like a sledgehammer in the face.
Right by the boo-boo.
And that's when the levee breaks by Led Zeppelin. John Bonham being, you know, considered one of the greatest, like, heavy hitters, but also one of the greatest drummers, and really pushing the limits of how hard you can hit a drum, and yet still playing with the, you know, frankly, motherfucker studio gods like Jimmy Page and John Paul Jones.
Amen.
Yeah. And so, without further ado, when the levee breaks, Led Zeppelin right here, barbershoppodcast.com.
The late, great John Bonham with the iconic When the Levee Breaks. Another great iconic song about to be born out of the wisps of the magic that's happening tonight. Nick Burson sitting at the kit, giving you something from the dark recesses of his mind. Right here, right now, at barbershoppodcast.com. A little something from the mind of Nick Burson. An electronic drum kit is a wonderful thing because the thing about the drums, it is, it's in your face. It's intrusive. It's there's no hiding it. And I've known so many drummers who've lived in apartments, who've built subfloors with inflatable inner tubes on pallets, and done anything to be able to practice their drums and not get kicked out, right? It's like almost in the early 80s, you could buy an amp that you could put headphones in. So if you're a guitar player, you could keep your place. That never happened for drummers until the advent of electronic drums. Now, it's like a pocket pussy, really. You know, it's
a flesh.
Your beat buddy.
Beat buddy.
It's wow. You know, it's close, but no cigar. But boy, it does things that the real one doesn't do. You know, so yeah. So if you can kind of go with that and accept the fact that it's not a real set of drums and yet a wonderful emulation, the technology, and obviously the people who are working on these things are drummers and they're constantly striving to get the feel, the bounce and the response, the time, right? Like when you hit, how you hit, how hard you hit, what part of the head you hit, what part of the stick mm-hmm. you use to hit, if you use a wrist, mid arm, elbow, shoulder, all impart sound. Mm-hmm. How the fuck do you get a little electronic drum to do that?
I agree. It's you know, amazing.
It's tough.
Sensors.
But
it's funny though, like you talk about that, because if you took a poll for drummers like everywhere, it's like, what do you think? Electric, not electric. Like, it's hard to say. Like, same with the click track.
Oh, Billy,
same with doing a metronome. If you took a poll, you'd probably get 50-50. It's just so, because I was so opposed to that kind of a drum set.
I'm right with you.
Just like, nah, that's not drums. It's not real. It's just synthetic. It's just all. But, you know, actually playing them, they're not that bad. They're fun. It's different. You got to be open to new things all the time.
Well, plus they don't sound like this all the time.
No, and imagine you were the kid who was playing on the drapes and on the laundry basket and on the other shit. And, like, that got dropped in your fucking lap.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Mind blown.
Yeah, so it's important to constantly remember that and go back to it.
For sure. The apartment thing, though, is like 100%, though.
Yeah. If you have an apartment, you need a set of these.
That's why I like to practice in my head.
All right. Now, what we're going to play a little bit from Nick that you picked is a drummer that I guarantee you 99% of the world has never heard of. Probably 50% of the people in the music business have still never heard of him. And yet any drummer constantly ranks him as their favorite drummer. And you picked Bye Bye Blackbird by the great Steve Gadd.
He's not necessarily my favorite drummer.
No, okay. But he gets referenced so often. What is it about
Steve Gadd? What I like about this is that he's playing a song in his head. You can see the guy at work, there's a song going, and if you know the song Bye Bye Blackbird, a little jazz song, I'm not a jazz drummer by any stretch, but I know the song. My mum used to sing it, and my dad used to play it on the piano. He's got the song going along in his head, and he's just playing brushes. It's really simple, but he's an amazing drummer.
Minimalist perfection. Steve Gadd, the great Steve Gadd, Bye Bye Blackbird, barbershoppodcast.com. Right, that is the great Steve Gadd, G-A-D-D, two D's if you're looking for him on YouTube. If you're a drummer, look for him. Learn, listen, you go to bed at night, you'll be stuck in your mind, maybe wake up in the morning. It's like a video game. Can't beat that level, can't beat that level. Wake up the next day, crush that level. Drumming, and we're talking about it with drummers, and...
You think the collective IQ in the room was like fucking plummeted, wouldn't you? four drummers.
No, that's why I went for the collective average. Yeah, so because like Adam's a schoolboy. Okay, he's smart. He's got a future outside of music. His thing is that music is like it's like crack alley. It drags him back, and it's a thing that makes him happy. And he's too smart for his own good. George was born with it. You know, you really can't shake it because it's part and parcel to what you do.
Rock and roll infection.
Exactly. It's like, you know, this is what I wear. This is how I step. Billy, I can tell the same thing with you. Like, I can't imagine you not drumming. You know, I can't imagine.
Me either.
You know, you're not doing. And Nick, it's like you're a great friend of mine, and I love having these discussions with you when we're so tired, both of us beaten and fed up with this industry and with this business and why we do it. You know? And I've said it time and time again, to be the top 1% of what you do and to struggle to make gas money at what you do. If you're the worst security guard in the world, you're making $10 an hour. You know, if you're sitting there watching a game, and somebody can come in and walk right past you, and you still make $10 an hour. And yet, you know, when a drummer, an accountant's like, by the time I get in and I leave, to the time I get home, I put like 9 hours in this night and brought enough gear, dollar-wise, the same as any plumber or electrician or anyone else, into a job, and I made $6.35 an hour, you know, and...
That's not why I do it.
No,
it'd be nice if I made some money. It can't, but it's not why I do it.
No,
I've
been scripting down my kits lately because of that.
Yeah,
you know, just bring a skeleton. Sometimes I'll just utilize a snare, just the snare.
Well, let's talk about that. What's the greatest trick as a drummer that you ever learned that made your life easier as a drummer? And anyone who thinks of one right away, pop up. I don't want to stick anyone.
Putting wheels on the bottom of my cases.
What's that?
Putting wheels on the bottom of my cases.
Because, again, it's like, I've often said, like, as a guitar player, I thought I had it pretty good because I had the lightest instrument. And usually if it had a sound guy, then you just need a combo of 40 pounds. So you're carrying 50 pounds, two hands. the drummer is carrying about 100 pounds, seven hands. And the bass player's got a huge bass amp, and his guitar is 15 pounds. So other than the singer, unless you have a singer, you're doing the best. But a comedian, oh, my God, that's the best. You just go, and they probably give you the mic for free, right? You don't have to carry that thing. But as a drummer, lugging gear and having a vehicle to lug the gear, and if you don't have a vehicle to lug the gear, to hire a vehicle to lug the gear to the place to set it up.
Being
on time and then miking it and whatnot, it's a big deal, you know.
Good luck.
We try.
It's funny you mention that, though, Kevin. I mean, I got this, you know, the bins you get in the city of Hamilton, they're recycling bins, you know, the green ones?
Yeah.
They stand about 3 feet, 3.5 feet tall. Wonderful they have fungus. A lid. Yep. What I did is I had a new one.
Fresh,
painted it black, stickered it up, and all my hardware goes in there.
Yes.
All my hardware, everything, all your cymbal stands, everything. It goes in there with a piece of rope. I put a nice knot in it, and I just wheel it. I got a gig in Toronto where I got to go upstairs.
Good form.
Golf bags really good, too.
The only thing you got to watch, though, at the end of the night, people are throwing in chicken wing bones and fucking, fucking empty beer bottles. And it's like, fuck off, man. Like...
That's my shit.
That's my stuff, man. If it was green, you could do that, but it's black. I painted it.
It's for my stands.
Oh, man.
All right. Rather than carrying the coffin case.
Now, I want to talk about, there's a kind of like a drummer school, a franchise, and less so now with the proliferation of... home recording and the internet and whatnot, but when there were music factories and there was like the Funk Brothers and the Swampers and Muscle Shoals and places where you could be a session guy and you could be a cornerstone. Like when you listen to Motown, you don't understand. It's like there's five guys or four guys on all those songs that make those various songwriters sound the same. Right? And that was the way it worked. It's like you picked the cream of the crop of the people who played. So I'm going to ask each one of you before we do another tune. When it comes to, you know, kind of the session drummers that no one's ever heard of, and it's only because you're a drummer, you're like, who the fuck is this guy? If there's someone that a young drummer is listening to this show and should like look up, and it's not going to be a John Bonham or a Keith Moon or a Neil Peart. It's going to be this guy who did this or had this. Is there someone kind of obscure and weird? Throw me a name.
Tony Allen.
T-O-N-Y-A-L-L-E-N.
Yeah.
And he is?
He's Nigerian.
Cool.
And he played for Fela Kuti in the 70s. You should listen to him.
Good. Billy, you got somebody who's kind of an unheralded drummer where you're like, you know, this guy kind of fucking spun my clock?
There's a local guy, Steve Negus.
Yes.
The guy's a lefty.
Yeah.
And it's just so cool to watch. Like I've tried setting up left-handed before just to try it, and man, I don't know how these guys do it. Well, I guess because they're left-handed.
Quite
but...
a bit of practice, actually.
Yeah, Steve was hoping to make it tonight, but he and again, and I said, I called a whole bunch of drummers, and it blew me away that the overwhelming reason why they couldn't make it was they had a gig or a session. You know,
they don't stay in and watch he shoots, he scores, he runs.
But Steve Negus, he was one of the early guests on here, and it was like, and I remember asking him, you know, and he said to me, he says, that's the best interview. He goes, I've done interviews all over the world, but that's the best interview I've ever done, you know, and because I knew enough to be ignorant, and I found out because you know him as a drummer from Saga, and you know that he was like a pioneer of the early 80s electronic drums, and he was fearlessly into that, and yet he cut his teeth playing race music. He was the drummer of choice for all of the R&B bands who were playing Toronto and across from Oshawa on the top. So he was very busy playing, you know, black music in the early, mid, late 60s. So come Saga, which is progressive rock, in that keyboard driven, heavy synth, saturated, gated, reverb world. And I'm like, why did I like this band when I despised all the others? And I realized because they got a fucking R&B drummer fucking playing those. It didn't matter that it sounded like R2-DT fucking 3CPO. It was more important that it was an R&B drummer playing it, right?
Yeah.
That would made it fucking sexy,
fuck,
right?
Yeah.
So Steve Nagus,
that's
he
pretty
will
be, sexy though.
Where's that sausage?
Where's my sausage? Everyone wants him. All right, we're gonna get it. We're gonna
sausage
get
sausages up to that.
George, I want you on the kit. I'm gonna move you on. Undo your shackles. And while you're getting ready, we're going to play your. Oh, we already did. That's
not
right.
Lower that seat, George.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To do what? Do that the good way.
I raised the seat.
Yeah, when the levee breaks. And you know what? Why don't we get him ready? Let's do it. Billy, he picked, my favorite drummer, Neil Peart. You know, because the guy's got the hugest ability and the smallest ego, and just strives. All he cares about is playing drums. His idol was Keith Moon, and I really like that. He's from Beamsville or Vineland, you know, right here in the Niagara region, this area. He is a complex, quiet individual. He's a master. He's a professor of the drum kit.
Born in Hamilton.
Right here.
Have you read his first book?
Oh, yeah.
I haven't.
It's interesting. Very interesting.
Well,
sad story, actually. But
oh, it's had a sad life.
I recommend it. It's really good.
Well, here it is. Tom Sawyer, right here. BarbershopPodcast.com.
Sawyer, mean pride. Though his mind is not for them, don't put him down as arrogant. His reserve a quiet defense, writing out the day's events. We'll be right back.
I don't know. That was Tom Sawyer. Was it?
It was Rush, wasn't it, really?
It was.
It
was Le Studio in the woods of Quebec. A wonderful studio that is now lying in semi-obscurity and ruin. It was up on it was up for sale. A starting bid of $16,000. Of course, very low to attract crazy buyers to buy a decrepit studio rotting in the woods that nobody wants, right? But you could... Yeah, you could repurpose it into something else. But it was the glory days when you had the big Neve console and you would roll it in and the 2-inch tape machine, and it was like building, you know, the Battlestar Galactica or something. It was like, nowadays it's all on a laptop.
Yeah.
But you can get a good taste, you can get a good touch of real music, and it starts with the kick and the feel of the drums. We have a special drummer episode going tonight. I spent $100 on liquor to make sure this was a good episode tonight.
I know nothing.
Where is it?
It's gone. It's fucking gone. But you know what? You people are the benefactors of it, because George is going to lay something down. Adam won't be able to keep his hands to himself because he's seen the sausage, and Billy's already got it. Billy's got it in his lap. Oh, man, you know, it's been out. So without further ado, everyone's got a different feel. Everyone's got a different take. And this is George's right here, barbershoppodcast.com.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Pa-choom-tsh.
Right on, man.
It even responds to the grab. Let's talk about the grab, all right? It's like when you were, like, when you first executed your very first...
I was scared I was going to cut my hand open.
Well, come on. It must have been like the first time you touch a titty or something, right? Like, seriously, with...
No, you've got to be careful. You go that little in, a centimeter too far, and you've cut into that part of your hand.
Yes.
You got to stop it.
Which is the most
right
sensitive part of the hand.
You've got to be careful.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a light undertaking.
Let's talk about shitty kits, okay? And I'll let you work your way back there. Work your way back there. And it's like, I love the fact that, you know, and I can't just say it with drums because I've seen it with guitars, with two-string guitars, two-string basses. Someone who's got a feel can take the most simplistic execution of physics and science and turn that basic instrument into a real musical expression, right?
Yeah.
So I've seen lots of kids, like, you know, African kids or, you know, playing on jerry cans and buckets. And like we all have. And to be able to play, you can clearly... exhibit, you know, all of the skills of understanding that element of the music before you are blessed with the $1,500 kit, right? And drums is kind of intimidating. It's like hockey for a kid. It's much easier to teach them soccer or football, where it's like a not good pair of shoes, maybe can run, where it's like, I don't know if my kid's any good at this, but I got to jump $900 in gear before I'm going to find out. And the same with drums. And you all talked about your early days where you knew you were a drummer and you knew you had drum skills before you ever had an actual drum kit. Uh-huh. And I think that is so cool. So I wanted you to talk about, and it may have been your first one, or it may have been like, have you ever been in a situation where you've kind of sat down in something and went, oh my God. It's like, this is, or have you had the luxury of kind of building the kit? Like, let's talk about gear a little bit, right? Because I'm a gearhead. Like, I like gear. And there's drummers who are going to be watching the show who are like, I like gear. And this is another thing. It made sense to me that as a guitar player, they're only this big. They're hideable. You know, I can buy four, you know, and the old lady only knows about two of them, right? Like, how do you do it with drum kits? Like, because you would think, oh, I'm really happy with this drum kit, girlfriend. And it's like, it says, but I want another one, right? It's like, I want that sparkly kit.
Yeah.
But I really like, you know, and then the brave, like you, will mix and match a kit, probably all of you, where it's like, you know, they don't have to be the same color. I like the sound of this one, I like the sound of this one. So, like, have a little gear talk. Like, you know, like make the drummers happy. Like, you know, let's talk about gear. Like, let's start with you because you're biting at the thing. Like, what do you like in a drum kit? Like, what are the things where you're like, okay, I'm looking at a car. I want X amount of horsepower. I want G, you know, lateral acceleration. I want this. I want this. Like, what do you want in a drum kit?
Well, it's funny because I feel like collecting different snare drums is kind of like collecting guitars.
Yeah,
it's weird. Like the shells of the toms and the kick. Like I've played the same toms and kick, and I've played the same shells since like 2004. Has been like my main kit every gig.
What
almost,
kit
right?
do you?
It's a Yamaha Stage Custom. It's nothing flashy, but it's the one with the. It came out early 2000s where the lugs come right off the drum. And it's actually really handy for if you need to change a head really fast, stuff like that.
That's super.
But I've mixed and matched snare drums over the years and stuff like that. And that is really, especially when you're recording and stuff too, that changes the character of a whole song, not just the kit. Yeah. It's like the snare is really important, that sort of intangible thing that the listener sort of hears and makes them feel. Like a snare drum can make a song feel happy.
It's
can make
voice
it sound
box,
fat, you know?
Of, yeah.
For a number of years, it seemed like the snare sound defined the drummer. There was
And the overall music. Look at the 80s, like huge
reverb.
Reverb, D2, snare,
boom. Yeah, well, Alex Van Halen, you know? Like you always knew when it was him, not besides the band, but you always knew that particular sound of his snare. And a lot of drummers do have that. That's my sound. That's my that's my thing.
Like the snare on Saint Anger in Metallica.
I saw a great meme for that.
It's
an example.
It's a trash can.
Hey, you're by the snare that Lars you'd use on St. Anger.
Pick up some St. Anger Lars abuse. Like, seriously, get on the internet right now.
It wouldn't be a drummer's episode if we didn't have a Lars.
Seriously.
Love your fans, Lars. Love your fans, buddy.
It's true. They call you on your shit, which is great. Let's talk about Lars Ulrich, okay?
Oh, yeah.
Let's do it. Because
next.
I love the thing. Yes.
Just kidding.
But no, let's abuse him because I want him to sue me so someone in fucking San Antonio will know who I am, right?
Although the guy was a smoking drummer, in my opinion, from Kill 'Em All through, you know, Ride the Lightning, Master of Puppets, and Justice for All. And then just from there, I don't know if it got to his head.
I think he stopped practicing kind of ever.
He became a producer extraordinaire.
Playing live, he wasn't playing his songs the way they were recorded. He's doing his own fucking brand new thing on everything. It's a minimalist thing.
He's trying to make metal this pure,
because
simple
this is
rhythm
important.
Blues.
We're talking about a band that is iconic. We're talking about,
yeah,
you know, and for huge. A drummer, he got as much props as Hetfield and fucking and Hammett and everyone else in Newfield, anyone else in the band.
Deservedly so.
But
he's a working guy, no
he
doubt.
Also caught the flack that a lot of people thought was undeserved, but they were really trying to kind of give a voice, and a lot of times, like, we're going to talk about this, like, you guys come in and you don't get your due and saying, I think, like, seriously, if I'm in a session and the drummer starts telling me that he thinks the guitar is out of tune, like, I used to have a big problem when I was in Captain Easy with Ernie, because he would say the same thing, and I'm like, you know, shut up, do your job, right? And it's like, I really need you to focus on your job and not talk about things you don't know about. But at that time, I didn't realize that drummers are the best person to really ask about that, because it's kind of the person with the best overall view, right?
Of
what's going on,
exactly,
right?
True.
I was younger and I was more ignorant, right?
But we have the most mindfulness, I believe.
Yeah, and if it comes to mind that you're willing to say something, they go, that sounds like this, depending on the amount of alcohol and drugs that are
sure.
in by the time, that's something you should listen to, right? And again, if you run into it, I think that all of you guys kind of elevated yourself to the situation that you guys get people calling you and asking you to play for particular reasons. But, you know, coming up and growing up, you know, in the business, was it tough to kind of go, geez, you know, I'm an alpha, you know, I'm an extrovert, I'm a fucking man-sized man, and now I'm being fucking shoehorned in a position? Was that easy? Was it difficult? Was it conscious?
Fight it every step of the way. Yeah. The only way for me to learn, I mean, I've heard some people tell me that you are only as good as your audience believes that you are. So I've always kind of keyed in on the responses that I'm getting from the audiences. So I think that's for me, that's the most important thing, is how the people are responding to what's going on in the drums, you know?
Right on. Right on, right on, right on. Well, we've had all of you, like, play, right?
Nope.
No, who hasn't played?
Adam hasn't played.
Who? Oh, fuck. Dude.
The best of the best.
The best of the best.
And this will give me a chance to play his baby.
All right, we're gonna say another little advertisement. Well, Adam Cannon, no relation to Ryan Cannon, if you can't tell by one is ecto and one is a ectomorph, whatever they call. Ryan's ass crack is bigger than Adam. All right. We're going to give a shout out to Taxes Done Right. Let's say hi to Heather. You know, because Heather takes care of my taxes. She should take care of your taxes, especially if you're a fuck up, right? It's like if you're a fuck up and you've got 100 little receipts and notes and things, and you've got like 4 years of back, and you're like starting to get worried, I should do my taxes. Get a hold of Heather at Taxes Done Right. She is the rock and roll tax queen. She will take care of your business. I will give you a Ginger St. James recommendation right now. Heather is my go-to business and personal taxes bookkeeper. Heather is a huge asset to me, and as a musician, keeps me organized, up to date. I would definitely recommend her services. She's done my taxes for the last number of years. She's totally understanding that she tells you something to do by tomorrow, and she knows that means 5 weeks, because, you know, you'll get around to it, but she takes care of you. And I gotta say, Taxes Done Right, go there.
It's all good. It's all legal. She's got all her courses. She got all her books. And if you tell them you're a Barbershop Podcast person or a Boxo Studio person, you're going to get a discount. And if you get a refund over $500, it's a 5% fee. It's only $25 for your personal taxes. Email. And all of this is, you know, look on the barbershoppodcast.com. There'll be a little link there. LQueenHMS@gmail.com. All right. Back to the drummer spectacular.
Yeah, baby.
Adam Cannon, no relation to Ryan Cannon, is going to be the next person playing and kind of moving and shaking the Box of Studio crowd. And he has kind of a little bit of an idea what he's going to do, but he doesn't want to think too much about it. He wants it to come from the groin. So from Adam Cannon's groin, right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com. dude.
That's some good shit right there.
That is right. It, like, it was not written. It kind of came as it went. It was right out of the get-go. And I love that. And you got to understand that if you are a fan of Barbershop Podcast, you're going to get that. You know what? Every 6 months, we're going to do a drummer show. I've decided tonight. Every 26 weeks. Every 26 weeks, we are going to have a drummer's spectacular. And we're going to bring in some of the great drummers. You got to understand why they are the core of what's great about rock and roll. And four of the most wonderful special guys came in. Guys, thanks for coming out
tonight and being a big part of my very first,
our very first drummer rock and roll spectacular.
Agatha Gersh.
Bucket of Fish. From Barbershop Podcast. .com.
Kind of shit.